Well then, it's time for the second round of the 2016 TCTwo Championship from Touring Pro Series with the RaceRoom Experience. It's the Audi Sport TT Cup, and after the thrills and spills of the Nürburgring, it's already game on in the championship. Jake Sanson and Robert Wiesenmüller in the commentary box, and Rob, we've got ourselves a really good championship battle cooking up now.
Yeah, hello Jake, hello everyone. Looking really interesting. Yeah, we're just one round in to the championship, but already we had a lot of drama in the first round. We had Alex Dornin looking like the clear winner in the first race, and then his brakes failed just before the end. And it was Etienne Bruns who took the victory. And then in the second race, Etienne Bruns didn't even make it through the first lap. So now Alex Dornin, despite his problems in the first race, is leading the championship on joint points with Garibaldi.
Indeed, with those two tying at the top of the championship, we can see the championship points on screen now. It's very close indeed. Dornin and Baldi tying on 52 with Schulze in third position there on 44. From Mangano, Baumgartel and Etienne Brun tied with Chris Hack running out the top six. Still very close and competitive. There's a few bits and pieces we need to explain coming into the second round of the championship. A few positions that, for those of you who are watching, look like they may have changed. That's because we've had a couple of discrepancies with the point standings from last time, with a couple of bits and pieces happening off track in the judiciary room. But so far, it has to be said, Rob, there's not been too many incidents we've had to look at. It's been a very good and positive start to the season.
Well, it's been very good and positive at the front of the field, I would say. In the midfield, it was a bit rough in the first race, and some people have gotten penalties. We do it like this in the series, that there are points penalties handed out. So, yeah, you don't get a time penalty in the races, but instead you get a points penalty overall.
I have to say, I think that works better than what Formula One currently does. Why don't Formula One adopt that system? That's something they should focus on for next time.
Maybe they should watch our broadcast.
Maybe it's a much
better
system.
We are already in qualifying, and yeah, at Zandvoort this time, we can see Alex Dornin, championship leader. He's leading in the qualifying as well, in the 142.7.
Indeed he is, and he's already going purple again in the second sector. Did a 111.986 at the split. So Dornin hoping to be gung-ho for glory straight away after his lightning pace at the Nürburgring. He's hoping that he's sorted out his brake issues, although I hear tell that he had similar issues in testing, which I'm sure we'll talk about in a little while. Let's see how he goes across the line, though. He's looking for a strong time, a 142.600. That's a full quarter of a second up on Etienne Bruns. He'll be very happy with that. Jens Blüdermann, we're watching now, as he is about 1.1 seconds away. But Rob, we were hearing that Alex Dornin hasn't quite got on top of the testing. Hasn't quite got on top of the brake issues just yet. They still seem to be a little bit of a teething problem for him.
Yeah, I talked to him before the race, and he still had a brake failure in testing here on this track. So issue isn't solved, I guess, but he's working on it. And looking at his pace, at least, he's definitely one of the contenders once again.
And this is a tough circuit as well, because there's a couple of really fast straights, really fast flowing sections of the circuit with two major braking zones. First of all, into Tarzan, and then later in the lap towards the stadium section. So there's some really big braking points here. So if you're going to have a failure with the brakes, Zandvoort isn't the place to have one.
No, because you don't have a lot of runoff areas here. And so I guess in Nürburgring you might get away with it, and I mean Alex still finished the race, but if it happens here, then that's really bad. That would probably be race over.
So we're just finishing off the final qualifying lap now, of course, and it looks as though it's going to be Dornin from Bruns and Baldi. We've gone straight over to the starting grid. So here we are, Jurgo Baldi in the third position on the grid. Then in fourth place on the starting grid, we have Schulze. We're on board with Baldi from the start line. And as the lights go out, we'll be racing here at Zandvoort. Two, three lights come on. Wait for it, folks. It's going to be a bit of a pause. Green, and away we go. Good start from Baldi. Already the charge to the first corner. Dornin gets across. That's exactly what he needed to do, to hold the line to the first corner. Tucked in behind him there, Etienne Bruns trying to get one over on him down to the braking zone. But Dornin holds the inside line. It's quite tame at the front through the first corner, but I have a feeling it's only going to hyper up from here. Bruns in second place. Then it is Baldi, Schulze, and then we have Platzke in fifth position from Müller, Baumgartel, Alcio Jr., Mangano and Toccacelli rounding out the top 10. But it's very close in the early stages.
Yeah, oh, and we see a small incident in the background there with one of the yellow cars involved in it. I think it was Jan Stange, I'm not entirely sure.
I think you're right, actually, Rob. Yes, he's certainly dropping back down the order. He's around about the 11th or 12th position mark, squabbling it out with Giorgio Mangano in the mid part of the lap, and a couple of drivers curb-hopping at the moment. We've got a spin in the mid-pack. Now, who is that that's gone? I think that is Kashkin that has gone round there, the Russian. He's dropped a long way back. Pavel Kashkin is the one who got spat out of the queue there, and that's unfortunate for him on the first lap. There he is, Pavel Kashkin, having dropped all the way back to 27th, 28th position, make that now. He's down at the back. He may well decide to call it a day.
Yeah, and it's very unfortunate that it happens, but this is a dangerous track. It's a track where when you push a little bit too hard, you're going off, and yeah, just proved like this once again.
And let's be honest, Pavel Kashkin, he is very frustrated, but at least he got further in than I would have done as they come through stadium section, through the left-hander, on board with Yanis Baumann. He's now tracking down. Now, who is that just in front of us? That's Alcio Jr., the Brazilian, as he gets onto the tail of the German Max Baumgartel through the double right-hander that completes the lap. You've got to get the exit of this just right if you're going to make the run to the first corner and see if you can size up an overtaking move. Alcio Jr. actually looks as though he's sizing up Max Baumgartel. He's got a good run there, smooth exit down the straight to complete the end of the first lap. It's Dorn Eden who leads from Bruns, Baldi and Schulze. Blatzka in fifth position, Müller in sixth, and this man, Baumgartel, we're riding on board with in seventh place. He goes very deep though, and that could be Alcio Jr.'s opportunity going into turn two. He might just get a good exit. No, Baumgartel's shut the door very firmly. That was a bit of a blip, but up towards the left-hand hairpin, he's gonna have to stay right on the button. There's Marco Müller, having a good scrap there with Robert Blatzk. They're having a good position now for fifth position they're battling over. As Dorn Eden, Bruns, Baldi and Schulze are starting to stretch away. Rob, at this stage of the race, the tyres are still not quite up to temperature and you're in the middle of a gaggle. It's so easy to make a mistake here.
Yes, it is. And especially in this track, it's also very difficult to make a clean overtake. So the drivers, they really need to wait and find a good opportunity here, because there are a lot of places where you could try a move. But most of the time on the corner exit, there isn't really enough space for two cars. But what we're seeing right now is that most of the drivers are staying quite patient, and I think that's a good sign, especially after the battles in the last race. They were a bit intense and did not look great.
They certainly were. Baumgartel has already used a couple of push-to-passes just to stay in this little tight group. Baumgartel's seventh position at the moment there, tucked in behind Müller and just in front of Alcio Jr., the Brazilian. It's good to see him up in the top 10, actually. He had a bit of a struggle of a weekend at the Nürburgring. Things didn't quite go according to plan. Now he seems to be back on his A-game. And it's good to see. We've got a little bit of fluidity in the positions this time around. Let's have a look at some of the movers and shakers elsewhere. It's not gone so well in the start of this race for Chris Butcher. He's there in about 11th position now on the back of Jan Stanger. We're looking at Giorgio Mangano. He's not had the greatest of second laps. He's dropped all the way back to 17th behind Jens Plutterman with Chris Visa in the mix there as well. And Denis Elmanenko just in front of them. So there's a lot of shuffling of positions. We've lost two cars now. I'm not sure who the second retirement is, but we have now got only 28 of the 30 starters. There's Chris Hack battling his way up into the top 20 as Denis Emelianenko has actually dropped back a little bit way now, 24th position. So he must have got caught up in the gaggle in the first couple of corners. And it's Hack and Plutterman that have dropped back a little bit. So I think those three connected, and Emelianenko is actually the one who's come off worse.
Yeah, I think one of the drivers that's out again is Toccacelli. I don't know where he is on the timing screen.
That's very true. Well, Davide Toccacello, yes, he's dropped back into 26th position. So yes, he's now back behind the Austrian David Yunt. There he is. Yeah. 13 pushes to pass still left. Dorn Eden and Bruns, that's the gap between them at the moment. Just under half a second, so there's not much change between those two.
Look at Toccacelli, look at the front of his car.
Yeah, he's had
been in an accident.
Definitely had a big punt somewhere. Not sure what happened to him. We'll have to have a look back at that one at a later date. But Toccacelli definitely taking some damage. Now, this is Platsk, and we're looking back to Marco Müller, still there in sixth position. Such a difficult part of the course, this at Zandvoort. You have to be so careful where you put the car and where you position it, Rob. It's so easy to get onto the grass.
Yeah, and I have to say, Marco Müller, he didn't race last time. He had a technical issue that prevented him from starting, but what a great debut in the series for him. He's been driving another series in TPS. He's been driving in the Virtual Touring Masters in the last season with the DTM 92 cars, and it's good to see him back, and it's also good to see him that competitive, running well inside the top 10.
Well, it's coming up that Alcio Jr. is leading the race. Now, what has happened here, because Alcio Jr. was at one point running in about 7th or 8th position. Now it's been... Now he's actually dropped out of the positions down to 27th. So Alcio Jr., do you think he's... Well, what happened there? Something's not happened with the Brazilian.
I think he's still behind Baumgartl on the track, so maybe he just missed a split and now he's not displaying his time correctly.
Yeah, that must be what it is. He's actually showing as having only 3 push-to-passes left, which is startling if that's true, because we've got 13 and three-quarter minutes left.
I think there's some sort of an issue. I can't really tell if he's lagging at the moment. My screen is lagging a little bit, so maybe my screen might be him. But yeah, that's not correct. He's still driving in the same position as he was before, which should be 8th.
Yeah, he's definitely there or thereabouts, isn't he, in the gaggle with Baumgartl and Baumann. Chris Butcher having moved up into 10th position, though, 2 places behind this. We look back, there he is, just coming into screen in front of Jan Stanger, the bright yellow and grey machine. Alcio Jr., the Brazilian, still there in the mix. Chris Butcher showing his 9th, he's actually in 10th position. Oh, that was a very brave move up the inside there of Yanis Baumann. Baumann is not going to give him the space, and he shoves him right there, almost pushing him straight onto the grass. That was you are not getting by that way. Come on, you know better than that, Chris Butcher, is what Yanis Baumann is basically saying. You're not getting through there. That was a really tough move from Baumann. Proof, though, he's got as much determination to keep him back as Chris has to come through. And if that one is accurate, 4 push-to-passes, well, Yanis has really compromised himself for the second half of the race. Here comes Butcher. Let's see how he goes right round the outside. No, they tangle door to door, and that's going to allow Stanger to come through. Is it? No, Butcher comes across.
Yeah, it's very difficult in this corner, even when you're going on the inside to get a run, because you need all the space on the exit. And yeah, Stanger just couldn't use the opportunity here. But yeah, Baumann is defending really hard, and we saw this on Nürburgring already, that he's got very strong qualifying pace, but in the races there's always a little train forming up behind him, and it's the same once again. And I think Butcher will not be really happy about the defense from Baumann, because that was quite hard. It looked like Butcher had the position almost, and then Baumann was just leaving no room in the exit. I'm not saying that I would have done otherwise, but yeah, certainly Butcher is all over the back of him.
It's a big risk going into that right-hander, though, isn't it? Because you're basically making yourself vulnerable going into that part of the course, because you know that if you haven't quite got the door shut for the left-hander, you give your opponent the opportunity to shut the door on the exit. So perhaps Chris Butcher deciding, you know, I need to go ugly early here because I'm losing a huge amount of time. I need to get myself into the top 6. Do you feel he kind of had to make that move to make it anything count?
Well, I think Butcher's move was very, very sensible. I don't think there was anything wrong with it. And I think he's got every right to try and make a move, and it was clean, and you can see he's looking again.
He is very, very close now, and he might have an opportunity. Baumann's gone a little wide, Butcher to the inside line, through the final turn. Surely he's got that one sorted, has he? Butcher trying to hold it, but they're so closely matched together, they're side by side, and here comes Jan Stanger for a look. I think these two are side by side down the straight, are they? Butcher still in there. No, Butcher has managed to get in front.
Whoa.
Very close, but who's that joining the party? That is Stanger trying to come right round the outside, and Baumann gets back to the inside line. Stanger's going to try and go back past Butcher as well. This is a great little squabble between these three. They're nose to tail. This is magnificent. And somehow, Yanis Baumann managed to park the car on the apex, on the exit of Tarzan, and hold Chris Butcher at bay. And now he's a sitting target for Jan Stanger.
Once again, that was really a hard defense from Baumann. And on the straight, it looked like he was going up to the pit wall at some point. It looked really odd, and then he still managed to keep his position in the first corner. And Butcher!
Oh!
How did he save that?
That was so close to being cannon fodder in the gravel, wasn't it? And that's allowed Stanger to come through. Oh my goodness, that was very, very close. Well, actually, hang on. Is that Stanger?
Oh no, Stanger has gone off.
Yeah, Stanger has gone off. We were watching briefly, that's Butcher. So, Stanger ran a little bit wide, and it's now... Who's that that's joined the party?
Leitner.
That is the Hungarian.
They're not finished yet.
It's still going hammer and tongs. Leitner's managed to drop back behind Jan Stanger. So now we're back on board with the Hungarian. He's got Stanger right in front of him. And all 3-4 of these drivers will be thinking, I'm losing so much time stuck in this battle. He actually gives Stanger a little bit of a nerf there on the way out of the left-hander. Come on, man, step on it. We're losing so much time. Meanwhile, back at the front, Etienne Bruns has been pretty much glued to Dorn Eden's bumper all the way throughout, and he now finally is thinking about having a look. He needs to be careful because we're into the second half of the race. So he sat right behind Dorn Eden for the entirety of this race. You have to say though, Rob, looking at the way they've come into this weekend, both of them the form men, maybe it's going to be a two-way tussle for the championship.
Well, I think that's a bit early. Oh, is he going for a move? No, he's not. I think that's a bit early to tell because we still have Garibaldi, for example, in third place, just doing his own thing, not getting too worried by the pace of the two Germans ahead of him, who's still scoring consistent points. But it already looked this way on the Nürburgring, and it certainly looks the same here, that these two are the two quickest drivers at the moment. And just look at this battle.
It's Baumann so
has
good,
been passed
isn't
by Butcher now and by Stange, but now he's got Leitner.
It's so good. This is the battle that just keeps on giving, isn't it? Baumann now down to 10th position. We've got Leitner in 11th
mistake.
Place.
Baumann touched the grass on the inside, and he actually got away with it, but that can cost you a lot of time.
Look at how much the car gyrates through the curb when you're using so much of the inside. The car just throws itself through the air as Leitner again gets close to Baumann. Now Yanis Baumann is having to use the inside line to cover the Hungarian Norbert Leitner. And look, Leitner actually gives him a shove all the way through the left-hander. They're going to be side by side. And I don't think Yanis Baumann is going to take that very kindly at all. He's going to hold it to the inside line. Don't you dare is his move to the braking zone. Right around the outside. This is so tight. These two are not giving each other anything at the moment. And back to the inside line comes Norbert Leitner. Yanis Baumann is going to be absolutely enraged at this.
I think this was a great move, but it's not done yet, and Leitner has the outside for two corners now, and yeah, you see it. Just... I don't think he can hold on to this.
Still side by side, and then eventually Baumann shuts the door, but he's compromised himself for the run down to Tarzan, so Leitner's going to be there again, side by side, down the straight, up through the gears, side by side, and Stanger's having a look in front as well at Butcher, so there's great battles all the way through. Leitner holds the inside line and gets it back from Yanis Baumann.
Yeah, meanwhile, at the front of the field, Bruns has lost a lot of time to Dorn Eden. That actually happened a while ago. It's now 1.5 seconds, the gap. So that's very unfortunate for him.
Yeah, he must have got it wrong on some part of the circuit to lose a good second to him, because in terms of raw pace, they are about the same. And Butcher has got nothing in response to Stanger at the moment. He just can't get away from him. And the German, Jan Stanger, again, just giving Chris Butcher something to think about on the fastest section of the circuit through those flat out right lefts. And that's a very difficult place to be able to defend, because if you get even a whisker of opportunity, somebody right on your tail is going to find a great sweeping pass. And Butcher is just lapping this up at the moment. Stanger giving him so much pressure, and Butcher is not budging. It's interesting though, if these graphics are accurate for the push to pass so far, Rob, Chris is there on six push to passes left, so he's actually been very conservative coming to the end of the race. The last time we saw the leader, Alexander Dorn Eden, I could have sworn I saw that he had nothing left in terms of push to passes. Let's have a look. Yeah, look, he's got nothing left, so he's very much controlling the pace out front, but he's got to hope that Etienne Bruns, look, Bruns has got eight push to passes left, so actually the man with the advantage to a certain degree here is Bruns, and he's surely going to be using them over the course of this next 5-6 minutes or so. He's got a chance here.
To be honest, I'm not quite sure if this is accurate, because if he has really eight push to pass left, why is he not using it on the start finish straight? It seems a bit odd to me. But either way, you can see that Bruns has already caught up a bit.
He has, yeah. He's taken again. You're right. He's taken a good 0.4 seconds out. We're on board with Diego Baldi, who in front of us we have Schulze. These two battling away, and don't forget that we've got Plansk in fifth position as well. So these three squabbling away over the final podium position, and this one could go right the way down to the final lap as well. All three of these guys very similar in terms of pace. A 1:44.4 for Baldi, a 1:44.439 for Klaus Schulze, and a 1:44.6 for Robert Plansk. But these two squabbling away has brought Plansk into the game. There's Schulze just chasing down your
man.
There's
someone off
position
in the background, isn't there?
Yes, you're right. Now, who is that that's gone?
Marco,
that's
Müller. Oh, that's so unfortunate. He had such a good race, and now he's been going off. And yep. I'm not sure if that was already a brake problem, because it's a... I mean, you can get it wrong in this corner. It's a difficult
well,
corner.
There goes there goes Leitner. Leitner's going to try and come through past on the inside, and Müller's going to try his best to defend to the inside of the left-hander. Don't even think about it, matey. And they're banging doors, banging wheels. Müller just manages to save the place. So he's lost. What has he lost? Three places there. It's Baumgartel who's up to sixth place now, Butcher up to seventh, and Stanger up into eighth position. Now, what has actually happened to Alcio Jr. now? He is way down in about 26th position, so maybe it was actually Alcio Jr.'s car that is all the way down the Audi. Yeah, there he is in 26th. I'll be interested to get a word with him later on if he's going to be able to stick around afterwards, because he was right in the mix of the top 10.
I think he's still 7th, it's just that the timing still hasn't picked him up. So he's missing a lap now on the timing.
Oh, okay, maybe.
Afterwards. Oh, yeah, and for maybe. Third place, you can see Schulz is looking. He's trying to get past Baldi.
He is having a think about it, isn't he? And it's getting closer and closer.
We had this battle before, hadn't we? In the last race at Nürburgring. And Schulz just couldn't find a way past.
So he's going to be wanting some revenge for that. He's already probably smarting for the Nürburgring. He's probably watched that video back again and again and again and thought, how can I get this guy? He seems to be weak here, but I just can't take advantage. How do I get him at the Zandvoort? And now he's got Platzke right on his tail. So with 3.5 minutes on the clock, he's in a difficult position here, Schulz, because he has to attack and defend at the same time. He's got to go for it when it comes to Baldi. But look, he's dropped a little bit of time. And when I mean a little bit of time, I'm talking about a car length. But that could be the difference between him getting fourth or fifth in this race, because Platz is looking very determined.
Yeah, and what a strong showing from Platz, because he was one of the guys who had a lot of problems at the Nürburgring. He also was one of the guys who scored a few penalty points. So it's good to see him here in the top five, battling it out. And yeah, he's now on the push to pass. Let's see if he can make something happen.
I think he's got to sit and wait to see what Schulz does, because Schulz is going to be battling it out with Baldi. He's
going to go for it on
the inside! That's very brave! He just charges up to the inside. It doesn't work, but now Schulz knows exactly what Platzke is made of. He's not prepared to sit there and wait. If he gets an opportunity, he is going to gung-ho.
And it's just 2.5 minutes left as well, so if these drivers want to make a move, now is probably the time to do so.
Yeah, it's game time now, guys. If you want to get the lead of this race, or if you want to win this battle and put yourself in a stronger points position, got to do it now. So down the straight, it's still Baldi from Schulz and Platzke in the battle for third position. Here is Platz again having a go. I think he's just trying to put Schulz on the back foot here. That was never going to be a serious move up the inside of Tarzan, but if he just gives him something to think about, it puts Schulz a little bit ill at ease. So he's just trying to create an opportunity by pushing Schulz a little bit over his threshold. He needs to get him a little bit more weak in terms of his resolve here. The only way to do that is to just keep on popping out to the left, popping out to the right. Is there a chance? Is there a chance? What if I create one? It might happen.
I don't think this would be the strategy that I would be using in Platz, because I would just wait for Schulz to try to make a move on Baldi, and then I would try to capitalize on that, because that if one of Schulz tries to make a move on Baldi, that means that one of them is not on the ideal line out of the corner, and then you have an opportunity to get at least one of them. I'm not sure if he really needs to put the pressure on.
It's a very good point, actually. Here's Davide Toccacelli in the second of the two BS Motorsport cars, his teammate.
No, that's a ghost one.
Oh, sorry, yeah, it is a ghost
teammate from Dornin.
That's right.
Oh, and the other white car's going off in the background.
Yes, that is. Now, who's that that's gone? That's Jens Plunderman. So Plunderman has had a bit of an issue there, and he's going to lose another place, storming up the inside. Thank you very much, says Chris Feiser. I'm going to go straight through. Now, here's the leading battle. Less than a minute to go now. So for Etienne Bruns, it really is now or never. And look at the gap. He's managed to bring it down from 1.4 to 0.6 of a second. Is history about to repeat itself? Dornedan, as they go into the final lap, has he got a brake issue? Is he having to nurse the brakes as we go into what is going to be the final lap?
To be honest, when you look at the gap to Baldi, I don't think any one of them has an issue. They are just the class of the field at the moment, and Bruns is really pushing. He really wants to win.
Well, here's the disadvantage Dornedan has. He has no pushes to pass. Bruns has one more. So he needs to get right back on the pace here and get right on the tail of him. Basically, down into the stadium section is where it's all going to count. He can work the car through this right-left-right sweep.
Oh, he's using it now.
That's a mistake, in my opinion. I think now is the time.
There's just no way that he can pass here.
No, I think he's wasted his best chance to get through there. Unfortunately, Etienne Bruns, he had a golden opportunity if he just kept the energy of the car travelling through and then got it right out of the left-hander and used the push to pass then. He might have had an opportunity on the inside, although he may know something we don't. Dornedan struggling for grip, struggling for speed out of the corners. Bruns might get a chance here. He's going to have to go right. Dornedan is going to make him go the long way round, but if he gets a good switchback on the undercut, he might have a chance. to get good acceleration. Look, he's going so much faster. Dorneydon is going to struggle here. He's going to force him to the left. That's the only way Bruns is going to be able to get through. It's round to the left. They bang doors. They bang wheels again. And again, Dorneydon shuts it. Now, Bruns is going to try one more time. He's only got two corners to get this, done now. Bruns has got good acceleration off the turn. Dorneydon's got the car as wide as a bus at the moment. Into the first of the right-handers. You're not going to get through there. This could be a run to the finish line. Etienne Bruns desperately trying to find a way through, but I think Dorneydon has done enough. Out of the final corner, it's going to be a race to the line. Is Dorneydon going to get the job done? Yes, he does. Fantastic battle. And Dorneydon just edges Bruns over the line. There was never any doubt that Bruns couldn't stop. They're still bashing after the line, would you believe? Baldi in third position. Schulzer in fourth from Platzka. Bauman is there in sixth position in front of Stanger, Butcher, Leitner. And in tenth position is Mangano. Where did he come from? I actually know. It looks as though it's going to be Müller. So, Müller, I think one of the... I think Etienne Bruns having gone off at turn one in frustration? I think it might have been.
Yeah, I think we also have Alcio Jr. in the top 10. We can't really tell, unfortunately, where he finished, but he should be in the top 10 as well.
Yeah, it'd be good to see where he ended up. Through.
And look how close it is in the midfield as well.
Oh, such a struggle. And those points, of course, could be the difference between a top three and not. Blüdermann just weaving over the line. It's not going to do him any favours at all. Oh, too much, actually. A little bit too much, mate. So the battle here at Zandvoort begins with Dorneydon and Bruns scrapping away for the victory. And it's Dorneydon who comes out on top this time. I'm not so sure he's going to be able to pull the same tricks for the second time in a row here, Rob.
Well, he certainly had to work for it this time already. And Bruns was really close, and I thought, to be honest, that he could make the move stick around the outside, because it's definitely a possible move, because you have the inside for the next corner. But Dorneydon was just... Look at this. I don't think that's still driving.
Surely they're not. Surely that's just the AI. I can't believe that that's them having a bit of a totalitarian dogfight after the checker. Surely not. So, yeah, it's interesting, though, in the battle, isn't it? Because they both showed their cards very late into the race. And it's interesting. If those push-to-pass graphics are correct, Rob, I'm surprised that Dorneydon had so little left to give in terms of boosts towards the end of the race. But we'll have to talk about that in a short while, of course, because we're getting ourselves ready for the second qualifying session. Drama in the first race, of course, but it's Dorneydon who takes one over Etienne Bruns. And I have a feeling there's going to be an interesting storyline to the fourth race of the year.
Hey there, I'm Christoph Hofbauer, and you're watching TCTwo on RaceRoom.
Hello again, folks, and welcome back to Zandvoort. It's the second round of the 2016 Touring Pro Series TC2 Championship, the Audi Sport TT Cup, from the beautiful and picturesque Zandvoort circuit on the coast of Holland. Jake Sanson and Robert Wiesenmüller in the commentary box. And I have to say, Rob, the quality of the racing we've had in race one, I think that's kind of fever pitch compared to even where we were at the Nürburgring.
Yeah, it was very good. And I really enjoyed the midfield battle, especially with Butcher, Stange, Baumann and Leitner. So that was just great how they were fighting for positions and how long Butcher actually took to get past Baumann. And speaking of Chris Butcher, I just had a small chat with him after the race and he reported to have a brake problem. So brake problems are happening again. Just before the end of the race, he said it cost him one position. So we certainly haven't seen the end of it yet. And it will be interesting if the drivers find out a consistent way of maintaining their brakes.
Absolutely. It seems to be the biggest issue, really, with this car that the drivers are trying to get used to, isn't it? Brakes over anything else. I mean, what is it? Is it to do with the car or is it to do with the challenge of this kind of event?
I don't really know. The problem is that you have very limited setup options. So you can change the brake bias, and I think you can change the brake pressure as well, but you can't change the brake ducts or anything like that. So just kind of have to deal with it and find a way how to drive it without doing any damage. And I think when we come to tracks like the Nürburgring, that would be a big problem for the drivers, actually. Here we can see the calendar now. So Nürburgring is on the calendar. It's still a while until it is, until it's on. But that's a track where I think you will have the most brake problems.
I tell you what, five tracks there I'm really, really excited about, even after this one. And this one's pretty special. The Hungaroring in Budapest, great circuit. The Sachsen Ring in East Germany. Spielberg, or known now, of course, as the Red Bull Ring. The Norris Ring is the coolest street circuit, in my opinion, in the world. It may not be the most exciting, it may not be the most challenging, but to me, it's the coolest. I really think there's something pretty incredible about those long, fast straights down to very tight braking zones. And then Hockenheim, of course, which is the jack of all trades in motor racing, isn't it? Rallycross, sports car and normal road racing on the various different configurations of the circuit, and even drag racing. It is the jack of all trades in Europe. We love the Hockenheim circuit. And it's a really diverse calendar, isn't it? It gives you a good deal of fast-flowing circuits with a lot of tight technical sections. But there's a lot of different skill sets you need to bring to the table here, especially places like here and Sachsen Ring, where there's not a lot of runoff. Places like the Red Bull Ring and Hockenheim, you've got a little bit more to play with in terms of what you can and can't do on the racetrack. Nürburgring, there's going to be absolutely no room for error.
Yeah, so for me as a driver, I mean, I've raced on almost all of these tracks already, and I have to say Zandvoort would probably be my favorite track of the season. I just love the circuit. It's an amazing circuit for a driver. And it's just got such a flow about it. And this is a problem with a track like a Nürburgring, for example, that it's, in my opinion, it's very basic. And it's not really a driver circuit. You can't really get so much time. So the racing is extremely close all the time. It's good for the viewers, of course. But then the races, sometimes it gets very hectic, especially with the push to pass then and the draft and so on. So, yeah, for me as a driver, Zandvoort would be the one that I'm looking for the most, or Red Bull Ring as well, which is a great circuit for passing.
All fantastic tracks. We're back into qualifying for the second race now, and we're looking at Giorgio Baldi. He is one of the chaps who's got a great opportunity to go for the championship. He is joint leader coming into this weekend, of course, third in race one. So that could make things very entertaining depending on where he finishes in the second race. But it's consistency that wins you championships at this level. So he's got a lot to play for here, and he's already purple in the first sector. So if Giorgio Baldi could actually get himself onto the front row of the starting grid for this second race, he's got a real opportunity to throw a bit of a spanner into the works. But again, Dorneydon and Bruns looking like the form makers in the early part of the first race, and it looked as though it was going to carry on all the way throughout. Here's Giorgio Baldi. He's just on a 1:12.2 in the second split. That's pretty good, but that can be beaten. We did see 1:11s in the first qualifying session, so it's a good start for Baldi, and that will be a very decent benchmark for the other drivers to push for. But now the pressure is on. Not so much more than it was. It's more than it was in race one, because with race one, you had an opportunity to feel where the car was going and see what you could create out of it. And look, already, he's just gone 0.4 of a second off. Now, Bruns has gone to the top of the qualifying with a 1:42.668. Now that is actually critical at this stage of the qualifying session. He's already found a little bit of extra something on Dawn Eden. Across the line comes Giorgio Baldi.
He's just about to start a lap.
Oh, sorry, he's starting a new lap. My apologies.
You can reset to pits, and then it will spawn you on the track, and you can just start your hot lap, and you can get a few laps in a short session. But yeah, good time from Bruins. I think Dawn Eden was on pole with the 6:00 last time. So
was
it's
indeed,
not quite
yeah.
the same time. So we know that Dawn Eden can beat that time. But what I find interesting is Stange is currently in third, but he's already 4 tenths back. So Bruins and Dawn Eden certainly look like the class of the field at this track.
They really do. We saw Emerson Luciani, the Brazilian. Now we're watching Alex Thiam, the Frenchman there, running in the top 20, but only just. He's actually just been displaced, actually, by your man in 19th position, Emelianenko. So he's gone up into the top 20. At the moment, it's Bruins from Dawn Eden by a shave under a tenth of a second. Stanger in third from Schulze, Baldi, Mangano, Toccacelli up in seventh place. That's good to see. Baumgartner in eighth. Then it is Müller, Alcio Jr., Chris Butcher, Robert Platsk, Visa, Hack, Bauman, Pavel Kashkin, who had that little off in the first part. Here comes Bruins. He's already going faster in the first split. Then it is Norbert Leitner, 17th in qualifying at the moment. He's a second away. He needs to find something big style. Meanwhile, Dawn Eden, look, this is his second split, and he just can't match Bruns at the moment. He's 0.054 back, so he's going to get closer to him. But unless he has a spectacular final sector, he's not going to get this pole position. And Bruns is actually on a faster lap by 0.077, Rob. This is going to be close.
Yeah, and it's looking good for Bruns because he's up on his own time, so this could be a new lap record here.
Let's see what he gets across the line. It's going to be tight. Yeah, look at that. 1:42.
Oh, Dawn Eden jumps in.
And then Dawn Eden. Oh, what a brilliant final sector he's done there. 1:42.609. Alcio Jr.'s had a good lap as well. He's just banged in a time half a second off the pole in fifth position. So we've got a really interesting battle now. It's Dawn Eden who leads the way. Bruns in second place. That's Stanger who's there in third place. That's a good lap. Baldi in fourth position now. Baldi in sixth place now. He's just been displaced because Schulze has gone to fourth. Then it is Junior in fifth position. Baldi sixth. Then it's Mangano, Toccacelli, Bauman, and Leitner rounding up the top 10. That's a really interesting mix for this particular race, Rob. That's a real shuffle.
Yeah. Dawn Eden and Bruns can't get another lap in. So if anyone improves now, it's probably going to be Baldi. But looking at his split times, it doesn't look like he will be going anywhere. And I think from the 15-second mark onwards, the times don't count anymore. So even
no,
though
I think
he
you're
finished
right.
the lap, he won't actually help his position.
No, I think you're right. I think Baldi is not going to improve from sixth position. But what an incredible top six we've got on the grid here. As we go straight to the grid, this is going to be an interesting one. Dawn Eden and Bruns on the front. And then we've got Stanger alongside him, Schulze, Alcio Jr. in fifth position. And then in sixth place, it's going to be that man, Baldi. So we've got a really interesting start to this grid. Bruns actually getting one over on Dawn Eden, and away we go. Let's see how it's going to go. Oh, sorry, Dawn Eden needed to get a good start there. Bruns moves to cover, and Dawn Eden is away in first position. Stango third place. Down to the braking zone for the first time in this second race. And it looks as though it's Dawn Eden from Bruns and Stango. Stango's mission now is to try and hang on to the leading two and not let them get away. Schulze are in fourth position. Junior's still there in fifth. It's a cracking start for Mangano. He's up into sixth place.
Yeah, good start from almost everyone, to be honest. I haven't seen anyone drop down a lot. Now we see De Verder dropping down at the back of the field. But certainly good to see Stange as well. So, so high up on the field.
Now we saw Kashkin going off at this point in the lap last time around. Is he going to be able to hang with it this time? Is everybody going to get through cleanly? That is the number 7 in the field, Baumgartel. Max Baumgartel trying to move up into the top six past Mangano with Toccacelli just behind. Then it is Butcher, Leitner. Platsk is only 11th this time. Hack is there in 12th position. There's a little bit of contact in the mid corner. It was a bit of a scary one. Now, who is that we're watching down towards the tail end? That's Marco Müller down in 28th position. So he's not having that great a race this time around.
Oh, and Koshkin again.
Yeah, Koshkin. What does this guy need to do to catch a break? Down in 29th position again on the first lap. Now let's go to Giorgio Mangano. running in the top six, having a cracking start with Junior just in front of him. And then it is it's going to be Baumgartel just behind. Although Butcher, I think he's made the move. They're side by side. Is he going to go right around the outside? There's not much to choose between them. He can't get by. Baumgartel holds the place for the moment. Butcher in eighth, then Platzke in ninth. It is going to be Baumann in 10th position. From Jundt, Daum, Luciani, Hack, Toccacelli. Hack has actually dropped back a few places on that last lap, actually. He's dropped back into what is, I think, 14th, 15th, 16th position for a brief moment. Then Hack becomes 14th place again. Toccacelli down to 15th, so he's had an incident somewhere.
It's once again, it's the fourth race in a row where Toccacelli has lost a lot of places in the beginning of the race. So I don't know what's going on there.
Is he making bad choices on the first lap, perhaps, or is it just going against him?
Well, we can't really see. I haven't seen what happened to him in any of the races, but it seems to be quite consistent, and that's very unfortunate.
Yeah, so it's German first, German second, German third, German fourth. They seem to be ruling the roost here at Zandvoort, with Alcio Jr. in fifth place, the Brazilian, and then Giorgio Mangano in sixth position in front of Baumann. One or two of the drivers going through the fast-flowing section of the course there. One or two of them going wide, I think. We may see one of them dropping down the order. But Mangano in sixth position, tucked up behind Alcio Jr. He really wants to get a top six finish, as Alcio Jr. He came into this weekend with only 6 points on the board. Plenty of speed, but no luck at all. So the Brazilian is going to be under some pressure here from Mangano, another driver who's got a lot to prove. He came into this weekend fourth in the points and didn't have the greatest of first races. So he wants to get straight back on with this. Can't quite find the move there on Alcio.
Yeah, and Mangano, he's the winner of the pre-qualifying, which was on this track here, on a shorter layout though, but basically on the same track. Though, yeah, he's certainly fast on this track. I don't think he had the best first race, though he's now trying to make up for it. And he's all over the back of Junior. I'm saying that he lost a bit of time in the final corner, actually, but I'm sure he will be able to close the gap again. And it's still quite close. And also Stange, he's not really dropping back from the leading duo.
On board with Baumgartel, Chris Butcher swarming all over the back of him, trying to find a way through. This is not going to be easy, but he runs a little bit deep and Butcher might get an opportunity. There's nothing in it between these two, as again Chris Butcher rolls up his sleeves and gets stuck in. You have to in the early stages, really. If you get held up around the third, fourth, fifth laps of the race, stuck in around seventh or eighth position, you can't really go any further than that, Rob.
Yeah, and I think for Butcher, the problem is his qualifying, because he's... Every time he's all over the back of the drivers. Oh, is he trying here? It's not a good place to pass.
He looks left.
I think he's trying.
Can't quite find a way through. This is so impressive watching Butcher just swarm around the back of Baumgartel's car like a cat after a pigeon. He's absolutely monstering his way over these apexes and up and over the curbs. I've got to find a way to get past this guy. Now he's going to launch it to the inside of the right-hander. Now if he can just put Baumgartel a little bit ill at ease on the inside, there's a little bit of a tag between the two of them. Butcher could go back for the undercut here. This is magnificent. He may not win every race, but I tell you what, Robert, he gives us all the action.
Yeah, this is a great battle here. And it's not over yet. But Butcher, he's trying now on the outside. I think this could work.
Oh my word! Oof. That's so close. Is he actually going to get it done? Yes, he does! What a sensational finish.
Oh,
driving.
And Baumgartel loses another position to Platzke, I think. Yeah, Baumgartel was trying to squeeze Butcher there onto the curb, and there's this big, it's like a plate, it's a big curb that they're coming
Incredible.
Up to, and he tried to squeeze him on it, and Butcher wasn't having it, you know.
No, indeed.
Tried to keep his car in there and gain the position. It was quite hard in the exit. He didn't give Baumgartel much room, but I think it's okay. I think they both equally were pushing it here. And
I'd agree with you. I'd agree with you. I'd say that move was six of one and half a dozen of the other. Meanwhile, Etienne Bruns, it's deja vu. He's right on the back of Alex Dorneyden now. Bruns has nine push-to-passes left. Interesting to see what Dorneyden has got left in his pocket, trying to
By
get
way,
away.
Where's Gergobaldi?
That's true. Where is Gergobaldi? He should be right in the mix. But for some reason, Gergobaldi is not in the top six. He's not even on the... he's not even on the timing screens. Gergobaldi... he's not there. I think he's out of the race. Now that's a big one for the championship.
Thinking about it, I don't know if he was ever in that race or if it was just out right from the start. Because remember, he qualified sixth. And then
yes, you're right, and I did.
Something must have happened.
Well,
at
something
the beginning.
In the back of my mind, I was wondering, is that just a technical glitch that is giving us why there was a blank space on sixth position on the grid? But I could have sworn when we were looking through the grid, I was thinking, no, maybe I just don't know anything about sim racing. Maybe that car should actually be on the grid, and it probably is. But now, hang on, something's going on here. Not sure what's happening. We've got some issues.
I think we've got a technical problem.
Oh dear. I think that's going to be a race stoppage. So problems there, unfortunately. So I guess that means then that we are on a little bit of a hiatus. I think that's going to need to be a race restart for the second. This happens occasionally. So we're just going to have to hang fire, and we'll get everything back to normal as soon as we possibly can. So we're back to the action here at Zandvoort. Etienne Bruns on the back of Alex Dorneydon, and still the battle is very, very close indeed between these two. Stanger in third position, Schultz in fourth, Mangano and Elcio Jr. having a great scrap, Butcher, Platsch, Baumann and Baumgartel having a great scrap in the middle of the top 10 there. So you haven't missed a huge amount, but it's definitely very close between these two.
Yeah, just to explain, it was just a problem with the broadcast, so the race is still going, there was no red flag called. The race has proceeded without any problems for the drivers themselves. It was just us and you guys, the viewers, that missed out on a bit of the action. But not on all the action, because you can see it here, Bruns and Dorneydon are still really, really close.
Yeah, we need to point out the graphic actually says that it's the last lap. It isn't. They are still going on. We're trying to get everything sorted out as quickly as we possibly can in terms of the broadcast server. But it's still the battle, Dorneydon versus Bruns at the moment, that we need to be watching at the front of the field. And here they are, still scrapping away. So Etienne Bruns trying to put one over on Dorneydon, and it's not going to be easy to get that job done at this moment in time, because Dorneydon has already proven in race one that he's got plenty in the bag to cope with what Etienne Bruns can throw at him. But interestingly, that's a big story in the championship, the fact that Giorgio Baldi, Rob, is not in this race.
Well, you still have to drop scores, so you can drop your two worst individual results. So it doesn't have to be like two races of the same event. You can drop one race from Zandvoort and one from, let's say, Red Bull Ring. That would be no problem. So this, you know, this DNF, it actually won't hurt Baldi that much. But the problem, of course, is that he can't drop a race where he actually gets a bad result. So it's still sort of a disadvantage for him.
Absolutely. And the other thing, of course, is that Etienne Bruns didn't finish race two either in Nürburgring, so he can drop that one. So technically, although it says on the time on the championship standings, he's tied with Chris Hack for sixth in the championship standings, the fact that he has a win in the bag means he's still very much in the hunt. So he's only in sixth position by virtue of the fact that he's had a retirement. But once he drops that score towards the end of the season, he's still very much a key player in this championship fight. It's Dorneydin from Bruns. Then 3 seconds back is Jan Stanger. That is the order at the moment you're looking at. That is accurate now. Klaus Schulz in fourth position. He says that, and then it all changes again. I do apologize. But Bruns still all over the back of Dorneydin with time running out on us. And that's going to make things very entertaining for the latter stages of this race. Bruns still throwing everything by the kitchen sink at Alex Dorneydin in his attempts to move up into the lead of the race. And Bruns, he is doggedly pushing away at this, still trying to get one on the upper hand of Dorneydin, but he's absolutely bulletproof at the moment.
Yeah, I talked to Alex before the race and I asked him, where can you pass on this track? And he just said, no one's gonna pass me.
That's a man full of confidence, isn't it? You're not getting past me. I wouldn't know where the overtaking moves are because I don't have to do any. Oh, that's incredible. Here's Klaus Schulze, fourth position, tucked up behind Jan Stanger. And then we have Mangano in fifth position at the moment, apparently, with Alcio Jr. in sixth in front of Butcher and Platsk.
Mangano got past Jr., so we were seeing him in sixth place in the beginning of the race, so he made the move stick, and now he's in the top five.
Yep, Platsk is there in eighth place, so he's trying to make a cut progress. In front of Max Baumgartel now, though, Norbert Leitner is in tenth place in front of Chris Hack and Nicholas Laubisch. Then it is Junt Tocacelli, recovering in 14th. Then Daniel Beck, Jonas Raivio, Alex Thiam, Pavel Koshkin, Arnaud Colombia, the Canadian driver, Carlos Pereira, the Brazilian, then it's Victor Koitler, Marco Müller, Mike Schneider, and George De Vider, all the way down in 24th position, and there are only 24 cars still running. It's been a bit of a race of attrition.
We lost Janus Baumann, who was at the bottom of the top 10 in the beginning of the race. He's out. That's very unfortunate for him.
I'm fairly sure we lost Jens Plüdermann as well. I can't see him anywhere, so I think Plüdermann's gone as well. Emerson Luciani nowhere to be seen either, so Luciani out of the race. We're going to have a go. This is Butcher. We're watching. Platzka's having a go round the outside into turn one. Surely he can't go all the way round the outside, although he is not coming up.
Oh, he's off. He's off.
He's gone wide there, so that is Butcher and Baumgartel through. And Platsk, that was a big mistake to a certain degree. Now, was that contact between the two of them, or was that Platsk just trying a move around the outside of Tarzan that just isn't possible, Rob?
I couldn't see if there's contact. Unfortunately, we don't have the sound, so maybe the viewers, maybe you guys have heard if there was contact. Unfortunately, we can't hear that. But it's a risky move, but it's a move that you can try around the outside in the first corner. It's a move that could work out, and unfortunately this time it didn't.
Well, Platsk is now the cork in the bottle to a certain extent, because he's really got a long queue of cars forming up behind him. Leitner, Hack, who we're watching, Laubisch, and not far behind this either is Daniel Junt. He's a few seconds back. There he is. So he could join this battle in a little while, depending on how quickly Robert Platsk can get back on with this. But Chris Hack is going to want to put himself back into the top 10. And he had a really strong weekend at the Nürburgring, scoring as many points as Etienne Bruns, the race winner. And here at Zandvoort, it just doesn't seem to have come together for him so far.
Yeah, and I mean, Chris Hack, he hasn't had that many so impressive showings in this league so far. I mean, he was pretty solid last time, but back in the day when we were racing on R-Factor, he actually won a championship in the Touring Pro Series, and it was also this championship, the TC2 championship. Back then we were using Renault Clios instead of Audi TTs, but yeah, he's a champion, and he's a very, very experienced driver, and he certainly can make his way into the top 10.
Well, it's worth bearing in mind that we've been to Zandvoort twice before already, of course, both in TC1 last year and last month, of course, as well. The previous winners in the past, Julian Kuntzer twice over, And then Moritz Leuna in 2016 in the Euronics squad. That's the same team, of course, that Etienne Bruns and your man in the battle, right in the midst of the battle, Robert Platsk, is racing for. In 2015, it was yourself, I do believe, Rob.
Yes.
You were right in the forefront.
I won the first race of the season, and then Miguel Nieto won the second and the third race. So, yeah, it's a nice track. I also won both races here in the Touring Masters on DTM 92. So, yeah, love this track. But what these two guys are doing here with the lap times, that's pretty impressive. And you can see once again that they're pulling a gap once again. I don't think I would win a race against these two in these cars.
They really are the class of the field, aren't they? Even Etienne Bruns, who's been so mighty, is struggling at this moment to keep in touch with Alex Dorn-Eden through into the stadium section, and he's lost a couple of tenths of a second just in that section of the lap alone. It's so difficult to run with Dorn-Eden at the moment. As he said coming into this one, nobody's going to overtake me, and he's actually proving to be right at the moment.
Yep, he is, and now we're back on with Chris Heck, and he is now in the top 10, so he made a move.
Yes,
I think Butcher dropped back. Butcher's only 12.
Yeah, what happened to Chris Butcher? That's going to be an interesting one later on, of course, as we focus on Butcher and Hack, two names synonymous with success in TC2. Butcher, of course, 5 previous wins in TC2. Reigning champion Chris Hack has 4, but of course, both of them have won 4 races on the road, as it were, because of course, Butcher's first TBS win actually came in the stewards' room 5 years ago, Rob.
Chris Butcher, he's won so many races in TPS, so it's actually crazy that he's never won a championship. The driver with the most starts out of all drivers in the, you know, in the history of the whole league, and he's still going strong. He's probably not going as strong as he hoped.
The Sterling Moss of Touring Pro Series, then, always a winner, never a champion.
Yeah, that unfortunately seems to be true, and this league looks like it's going to be the same once again. And he's showing the pace over and over again in these races. And I think maybe if, I don't know about Dorn-Eden and Bruns, they're looking a bit like, you know, like they have a small gap over everyone else. But maybe if they have a bad round, Butcher has a good one, I think he could win a race. But for the championship, it's, yeah, it certainly looks like it's not going to happen again. And that's quite unfortunate for him, because he would deserve a title after, you know, trying hard for so long. And I remember one time he missed out by a single point in the mini, so yeah.
I'm trying to focus on how long we've got left, roughly, because I know that
we're on the penultimate lap, actually.
We're on the penultimate lap. I'm glad you've been keeping up, Rob, because unfortunately our timing screens are not really keeping on top of how many minutes we've got left, but we're on the penultimate lap. I'm glad you've been able to keep up with that, Rob. We're about to go into the final lap then, and here is Bruns right on the pace with Dorn-Eden, and Dorn-Eden actually made a mistake on that final lap. I wonder, are his brakes going? Because only a few corners ago, he was a second in front of Bruns. He's just lost 3/4 of a second. I wonder, has Dorn-Eden got himself into a situation of complacency again? Is he going to lose this race on the final lap, or is he going to have that car as wide as a Buick again?
Yeah,
on
he's
board with Dorn-Eden.
It was still looking good though in the hairpin with his line, so I think Bruns really has to try. And I hope this time, I hope for Bruns that he has a push to pass left for the back straight this time. He hasn't used his last one. We can't rely on the push to pass.
He's gonna go for the inside line! I think that's a mistake from Dorn-Eden! Surely this could be the opportunity for Bruns to go down the inside! They tangle! There's a little bit of contact. Dorn-Eden still there to the inside line. He forces Bruns to go wide so that he can hold the inside line. Bruns isn't going to be happy about that one. He's going to try and stay to the outside line. Dorn-Eden shuts the door. Bruns needs to keep his foot in here. This is going to be so tight. He's on the inside line. He's got a chance. Bruns is going to throw it to the inside line. Down to the braking zone. He's there. He's through. Now, can he hold it through the exit?
That was a great move.
Oh, such a sweet overtaking move from Etienne Bruns. Bang on the money, and I think he's just bought himself a victory. 2 corners to go. Dorn-Eden will be absolutely enraged that he let Bruns get an opportunity. Into the final turn, down the straight, power through the gears. Surely this is Etienne Bruns' finest hours. He's got a chance, but I'm sure Bruns has got this one in the bag. Yes, what a fantastic fight it's been in the 2 races here at Zandvoort. It's 1 apiece. Dorn-Eden and Bruns, absolutely mighty that's Etienne Brunt. I genuinely thought he'd run out of tricks there. He kept it honest. It was that crucial move through the slow left-hand hairpin. He just kept his foot in on the outside line and bang! There's nothing Dorn Eden could do to respond to that. Mega!
Yeah, Dorn Eden, he made a small error in the right-hander before. And it just allowed Bruns to, you know, not really to go alongside, but it forced Dorn Eden to take a defensive line. And that just set Bruns up for the next corner. And he was trying to, you know, to go around the outside, and he had a push to pass on the back straight. He just used it perfectly, and then he got a breaking right into the chicane and just made a brilliant move. So Bruns wins from Dorn Eden, and Schulze, who got by Stange towards the end of the race.
He did! Yeah, right at the very last. We didn't see that. Mangano in fifth place from Alcio Jr. Then it's Baumgartel who comes home in seventh in the end in front of Platsk, with Leitner in ninth place and Chris Hack rounding out the top ten. Chris Butcher falling away to nowhere by the end.
I think so. Butcher already left the server, but he definitely finished the race.
I think he was around the top. Yeah, I'm sure he was around the top
ten.
Must have
been like 12th or 13th.
Wow. I'm absolutely flabbergasted. I'm lost for words there. The best move you could possibly pull off on the final lap. And I can't wait to talk to the guys after an absolutely cracking race. We will, of course, as we always do, talk to the drivers after thrilling encounters. That was absolutely supreme racing driving. And when we come back in just a couple of minutes' time, we'll catch up with the movers and shakers in, ultimately, that could end up being the best weekend of the year. We just don't know in the early stages of this. Dorn Eden showing his pace, but Etienne Bruns showing the joker in the pack. What a sweet way to end the weekend. Wow, we're still reeling from some absolutely incredible racing here at Zandvoort. It's been a really exciting weekend of action, two brilliant races, and it's a win apiece for Alexander Dorn Eden and Etienne Bruns, both of whom absolutely stormed the crows around the Zandvoort circuit, really showing incredible speed, guts, guile, determination, you name it, they had it. And Rob, some absolutely cracking racing from both encounters.
Yeah, and actually, when you think about it, both races were quite similar in the setup, but the outcome was different. So in the first race, Bruns was all over the back of Dorn Eden already, and then he couldn't make the move stick, and we thought it might maybe repeat in the second race, but then Bruns pulled off a great move at the end.
Absolutely astonishing. Well, let's talk to the drivers who made that race so special. We'll start, first of all, with the winner of race one and the runner-up in race two, Alex Dorneyden. Alex, absolutely fantastic driving throughout. You really seem to have the pace from the word go.
Yeah, thank you.
And let's talk about that first race, because you had a huge amount of pressure from Etienne Bruns in race one, but you were able to control pretty much wherever you put the car.
Yeah, both races were pretty intense, had a lot of pressure from Bruns. And yeah, I wanted to save the tires and the brakes, but it was difficult because I had a lot of pressure. And yeah, in both races at the end, my brakes, I had brake failure at the end a bit, not that much, but yeah, Bruns hadn't the problem, I think. He could catch up, and yeah, was close fight in both races at the end.
Absolutely brilliant. And it's going to be a really interesting battle to see how this goes on to the next round of the championship of the Hungara Ring, because you've all really shown your class in this first second weekend of the championship. Where do you think is going to be the key factor for the Hungara Ring?
Sorry? Once again?
I was just asking, yeah, what do you think is going to be the key element in terms of getting at the front of the field again at the Hungara Ring? What do you think it's going to be?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the quali is very important on the Hungara Ring, I would say, because it's really difficult to overtake there. And pretty intense track. It's a bit similar to Zandvoort, I would say. Hard to overtake, yeah.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Alex, for giving us so much brilliant entertainment out there. A win in a second place that keeps you right back at the front of the field. So brilliant. Well done.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, Rob, I think you've managed to catch the other man in the equation.
Yeah, Etienne Bruns. Great weekend from you. Congratulations on your win. And please talk us through the move on the last lap.
Oh, yeah, it was a very intense race, but there was a small gap, and I don't know if Dorneyden don't see it or he just let me enough space, but it was enough to drive up to him, yeah, and then it was done.
So it certainly looks to me as if you and Alexander have the edge over everyone else at the moment in this championship. So how do you see the season so far, and how do you think it will go on?
Yeah, I think it was a good recovery from Nürburgring, where I forgot my setup, and then I had to pit. But we should not forget Baldi or Tocacelli. I think these guys are also very quick, and I think it's not a race against Dorneyden. There are many other people who have the pace.
All right, well, we're certainly hoping to see such a showing from you again at the next round.
Yeah, me too. But first of all, I have to buy Hungaro Ring. To be honest, I never drove there before.
Wow, okay.
Maybe it was stupid to say, but yes.
All right, so the excuses are here early, even though we haven't seen.
Ah.
Anyway, thanks a lot, and back to Jake.
Fantastic. Well, okay, that's the first card shown to Alex Dorneyden there. He's never driven the circuit, so that could be interesting. Let's chat to one of the guys with a bit of frustration over the course of the second weekend, our very own from Great Britain, Chris Butcher. Chris, it's been a difficult one for you, really, this weekend, because at Nürburgring, there was a lot of pace, there was a lot of promise. For one reason or another, Zandvoort hasn't really come together for you.
Yeah, it never really has, whatever car I've driven here, to be honest. It's a bit of a bogey track for me. And I've not really had as much time as I would have liked to be able to practice. But, you know, real life has to come first, unfortunately. And, I've struggled. I was stuck in the midfield a bit where I personally thought driving standards were a little bit hairy. Yeah, disappointed. I think my one lap pace could have been better. I could have been a bit higher up in qualifying and maybe out of the mess, but it is what it is.
It's so difficult at circuits like this where it is tight and it's so twisty, because I guess if you can't get it together in that one lap in qualifying to really put yourself in the top three, then you're going to be struggling for the rest of the weekend.
Exactly. I mean, it's like you say, it's so tight, you know, it's relatively easy to defend your position around Zandvoort as well. So a lot of your moves have to be done around the outside. You have to be able to carry so much more speed in. So, yeah, your qualifying is really important, and as it is at most tracks, really, even more so here. Yeah, I don't really know what else to say, to be honest.
It must be really disheartening when you know in your heart of hearts, you know, looking back over your career in TC2, you know, you've already won here 5 times, so you should be right at the sharp end with everybody else.
Should be, but I'm not, so there's some work to do. I mean, I was talking to you earlier, and it's going to be a bit tricky to justify putting the effort in for the remainder of the season, to be honest, because like, I've lost my drop scores already to the last round, because I won't be able to attend that, so... Yeah, I need to do some thinking and work out what I want to do.
Okay, well, hopefully, Chris, we will see you at the next round of the championship at the Hungaroring for the entertainment factor alone. I mean, you put in some fantastic battles and some great moves. We'd love to see you back, but ultimately, we know you've obviously got a lot of thinking to do, so thank you for the first 2 weekends so far.
Thanks, Jake.
So let's move on from Chris Butcher. And Rob, you found Klaus Schulze.
Yes, and that will actually be the last interview. Then we have to wrap it up here. So, Klaus, once again, a very, very, very solid event for you with the 4th place and the podium. And actually, in the 2nd race, we couldn't see the move that you made on Jan.
Yeah, it wasn't quite the move. Jan did a mistake on the chicane, so I could easily pass him. Was lucky to do that, and so I got the 3rd place.
It looks like you're scoring points every race, and a lot of points as well, so... What do you think are your chances in this championship?
I don't know. Maybe I can fight for the championship, but then Prunes and Alex have to get each other out of the race one time, so I can score more points than them because of the pace. They are much faster than me.
All right, and you know, looking at the rest of the league here, is there any track that you are looking forward to in particular?
Maybe Spielberg, because I always liked that track, and in the Summer Cup of the DTM I could win there once. So this may be the track where I have the best chances.
All right, thanks a lot and good luck for the next race. And yeah, back to Jake.
It's absolutely fantastic when we consider what we've had in the first 4 races of the year at the Nürburgring and at Zandvoort. We've had drama, we've had intrigue, we've had a lot of drivers coming up very strong in one race and then falling away a little bit in the second. Then we've had drivers who have been consistent in all 4 races. So far, Rob, although we've got a rough idea as to 2 drivers in particular, Alex and Etienne, who have definitely got it together for both weekends, there's still at least 6 drivers out there who could spring a surprise through the remaining 5 rounds.
Yeah, and I think with Klaus and with Gergo Baldi, you have the 2 drivers who are very consistent, always going the points. Okay, Baldi didn't start, I guess, in the final race here. But in the races before, he has been really consistent. And there's also other drivers like Crocacelli, for example, who shown flashes of pace, but just couldn't convert it into results at all. And then other drivers like Platzk and Stange, who had a strong showing this time around. Drivers like Butcher were strong last time, Mangano, who might do a surprise. So even though Bruins and Dornin had a bit of a gap this round, I don't think it will be like this every round, and I'm sure we will see a surprise winner.
It's going to be an interesting one as to who is going to wrap up this championship, and we now know a little bit more about who is likely to be fighting all the way throughout. So you've got your calendar in front of you there. Book it in your diary. The 13th of July will be the next round of the championship, exactly 2 weeks from now. Same time, same place on the Hungaroring circuit. And having walked the course myself last year during a Ferrari Challenge weekend, I know exactly how tough these guys are going to find it. Lots of undulation changes, more than you'd think to look at it from the outset. It's a very fast, technical, sweeping sort of circuit. In touring cars, it's difficult to pass. But you can get a real surprise on your opponents if you know where to find it. So that's going to be a really interesting challenge before, of course, we head on to the Saxon Ring, to Spielberg, to Nürburgring, and then we finish off the championship on the 7th of September at Hockenheim. The big prize on offer, of course, a drive in an Audi Sport TT Cup at the end of the season. It's going to be really, really exciting to see how that goes. We're going to close up here. Myself and Robert Wiesenmüller, a huge thank you. Jake Sanson signing off here from the second round of the championship. In 2 weeks' time, the battle will resume.